All right, so in a second part of this lecture series on perturbation theory, I would like to focus on the solution of perturbation theory for a most basic and minimal model of the hot Big Bang type universe. And that is a model which has two ingredients. That is pressureless matter as one component, and relativistic radiation and particles as another component. So we need necessarily two of them. So we need matter in order to grow the structures and build the structures like galaxies. And we need relativistic radiation to explain observation of a cosmic microwave background, actually existence of a cosmic microwave background, which leads us to conclude that at early stages, universe was hot, and as a result, temperatures was high, and essentially all matter components, with maybe some exceptions, were relativistic at the time. So before, and well before, writing down perturbation equations using our knowledge of gauges and choosing particular gauge from the part one, I need to set up a problem and to discuss background in a little bit more detail. So we will be working with a conformal time as our time variable. So background Friedman-Robertson-Walker type metric will look like d eta square minus gamma alpha beta dx alpha dx beta, where this is a fixed special Kamuvian cross section with some metric. But for a flat metric, we have minus, say, dr square minus r square and d omega square here. Right? So Friedman, evolution of a scale factor is governed by the Friedman equation. And you perhaps will recognize Friedman equation immediately in the terms of an ordinary time. So dot will be the differentiation with respect to proper time as a dot over a square equal h0 square. And we have pressureless component, which we'll call matter for short, and it has an equation of state that makes its density drop as a cube of a scale factor. Then there is a radiation, which energy density drops as a force power of scale factor. And in principle, modern-day cosmology concludes that there is something that as a lambda term here. So all omegas sum together will get unity, of course. Right. Now, I will not be talking about phenomena associated with the lambda term that much, maybe just make the comment at the end, from the point of view of perturbation theory. Lambda term starts playing a dominant role in an energy balance only at a very late times, near the present time. But at an earlier time, since you're going back, scale factor goes to become smaller and smaller, matter radiation terms will beat lambda term. So scale factor is normalized, so at the present day, it is equal to one. So let me write the same expression in terms of conformal time and the relation between the conformal time and ordinary time, that it is equal dt over scale factor, which is clearly see from the metric if you realize that proper time is just dt square is a product of those two things. So conformal time has a meaning of a Kamuvian horizon, well, multiply by C if you want to measure it in megaparsecs. And this is again can be easily seen from the metric form, because geodesic equation for the light propagation in a radial direction will simply give you d eta equal dr c when the interval vanishes, and I'm going in radial direction, so not in an angular one. So if I integrate it, eta gives me a distance that the light propagated from r equals zero. And if it is Friedman-Robertson-Walker type ordinary cosmology without inflation or anything, then it is the beginning of a Big Bang, so it is a finite distance, and finite distance is how far horizon is in commoving coordinates. Again, r is commoving coordinate here, so it's background commoving coordinate. Notion of a horizon is global, not local, so you need to know your evolution through the whole history of the time variable in order to conclude whether there is a horizon or not. And formally speaking, if you add in the beginning of the hot Big Bang model inflationary stage, then horizon is kind of infinite, it doesn't exist. But eta nevertheless gives you a characteristic scale at each time moment. Well, it can be seen from this integration, so that if I integrate d eta, so it is integral of dt over scale factor of t from something early to the present time. And it is a question whether your integral is convergent on a lower limit or not, tells you whether you have particle horizon or not. And with the presence of an early time inflationary model, this integral formally will be infinite. Right, anyway. So that was highlighted in a discussion of the background on inflationary lecture for you. Okay, so I will now look at sufficiently earlier stage where I can. Let me convert time derivative with respect to proper time to conformal time, and if you see, it is only one over a scale factor in the first derivative that would be different. I will use prime to designate derivative with respect to conformal time here. So everything I will get 1 over a square factor here if I replace dot by prime square, because I had square of the derivative. So now if I will look at an earlier stage, sufficiently early stage that lambda term is neglected, I have an equation a prime square, and it will be equal h0 square omega m a plus omega r. And in contrast to the proper time expression, this has a very simple closed form solution, which covers both stage when radiation dominates and stage which matter dominates. Of course, at very early time when scale factor is small, this will be winning. At later time, this will take place, when take over. We know that omega r at a present day, something like, well, omega r is something like 10 to minus 4, and omega matter is something like 0.3. Okay, so that's a useful solution to remember. Conformal time comes comes helpful in this sense, and it has the form A is equal A0 eta eta plus eta 0. If, and I will not make explicit distinction with some letters, but I will use conformal time in the units of a present-day Hubble constant, right? So I will essentially replace H0 eta by, eta tilde, which would be a dimensional variable. And I will drop tildes. So I will not use tildes here. So substituting this form in the equation, you can find out what eta zero and A zero is. And A zero is omega meta over four. And eta zero is four over omega meta square root of omega gamma. Notice that that has introduced some characteristic time and also scale, because that is a particular Kamuvian scale right away into the problem. So if I will draw how my evolution of a scale factor looks like as a function of conformal time, then at earlier stages when eta is less than eta zero, it goes linearly. And at a later stage, it goes quadratically. So in a kind of log, kind of, I don't know, is it log-log plane or what? Or it is just schematic one. So it is linear, and then it is quadratic. So this is proportional to eta, eta zero. This is eta square and scale factor. And characteristic time is eta zero for the transition in this behavior. And so let us have a look at what is the value of it for modern day parameters. So if it is written like that, it is in dimensional quantities. So you want to multiply by C over H zero to get megaparsecs real here. And this value is approximately 550 megaparsec Kamuvian scale. For kind of your best value of H0, 68, around 68, omega gamma, whatever we like right now, omega m around 0.3. Now, if I will continue this evolution when lambda kicks in, then my evolution will turn around, and essentially, if it is really pure lambda term, will tend to go towards a constant. And somewhere here is a present time, well, when the scale factor reaches unity. But where exactly in time is the present time depends whatever what I'm do with the lambda term. However, early stage in this variable is fixed, and lambda term is independent, and value of the Kamuvian scale is also fixed. Notice that this eta zero scale is not exactly the scale when two energy densities are equal to each other. So it is a little bit different scale, right? So definition of A equality, which is A zero eta equality plus eta zero is omega r over omega m. Now, if you will solve this equation and find out what is the scale for equality, then it is almost five factor of five smaller than eta zero. To be exactly, I think it is square root of 2 minus 1 over 2 eta 0. So it is somewhere here. And it is something around, I don't know, 115 megaparsec, I think, if with the same. I'm not exactly sure for the third digit in my calculations. So this is another characteristic scale, with some difference. If you actually check what is the difference in the scale factor between these two moments, then A equality and A zero. Well, A zero, that's a misused. A zero I use for something else, but A eta zero, right? Then you find out that it is actually exactly 8. A equality. Anyway, so another scale of the problem, which is kind of less relevant, well, less relevant to simplify description of perturbations that we will use, but it's critical to study cosmic microwave background in detail, is a scale of last scattering, or moment of the last scattering of the photons, which is close to the moment of the recombination of the hydrogen. And with modern cosmological parameters again, so this thing where our recombination took place actually dependent on a detail of a late time evolution of the model. Scrap that. I'll have to think about it. T divides scale factor. Yes, because I know this ratio of the scale factors between present day and the combinations that I need, around 1100, since it is determined by physical amplitude, physical temperature that I have to have at the moment so that hydrogen recombines. So with the cosmological parameters that we have, it is somewhere between. So eta of last scattering, or eta recombination. That's not exactly identical things, but more or less somewhere here. Just let me check what I would like to say more, right, about that. Okay. All right. So why is it important? So that is just to put scales up, is for the following reason. So let me now look at several comoving scales which will appear in a perturbation series as a function of eta. So comoving scale, some scale. I will plot several curves. So first of all, it is a Friedmann FRW horizon itself, which is eta. That's an interesting scale and very easy to plot. It's a straight line. So somewhere here at the back, it is a present day. Eta now, which I don't even want to derive. It depends on lambda term and all those things. So another comoving scales that appear in our problem. Right, so let me mark interesting one. So that is eta zero is here, and eta equality, I'll put it somewhere here. And in between, there is eta last scattering or recombination somewhere here. So that's kind of so trivial plot that it is not obvious why am I drawing it with such beautiful linear precision. Well, I would like to plot some other characteristic scales that appears of the problem. And our favorite one in a perturbation theory is a wave vector k, which appears as an eigenfunction, wave vector value magnitude when we expand all our perturbation derivatives, special derivatives in plane waves. So it is a scale that is determined on a comoving hypersurface of a constant time, so it's a comoving scale. Therefore, as an evolution, it does not change. So if I will plot here, well, k is a wave vector, so it is inverse length. So it is k minus 1 that I should be plotting as the scales rather than k. So if I will put k minus 1 here, which has a particular value, then that is what is happening with that. And if I will put k minus 1 as another value, it will go like that. And I may notice that this value corresponds to the eta 0 minus 1. So this one is actually equal eta 0, right? K minus 1. So this is how wave vectors of a given mode will change. And let me put two more. The one which passes here is actually equal to equality scale. And then there are some scales which go even below. So as a function of time, therefore, a given fixed commoving scale compares differently with the scale of the Friedman-Robertson-Walker horizon. So Friedman-Robertson-Walker horizon grows linearly, commoving scales of the wave are fixed, and during the evolution, the quantity k eta starts low but becomes large. So it goes from small to large. So regions when it is small is comparing with unity, larger than one or less than one, and the region when it is less than one is the one above horizon line. So I will slightly kind of shade it a little bit like that. And this is the region when k eta is less than unity. On the opposite side, k eta is exceeding unity. And loosely speaking, we are talking about first part of the diagram is that the mode is outside of the horizon. The language is used meaning the wavelength, well, k minus 1 scale is larger than horizon. And on the second thing, it is inside horizon. And we are saying that during Friedman-Robertson-Walker evolution, perturbations enter horizon as the evolution, as they are involving. All right, so now this situation with the scales sets us up in different regimes with respect to the solution of perturbation equations. And we can achieve different level of analytical advances. And of course, computationally, it's easy to solve for whatever wave number through the whole history numerically, but I would like to just do something analytically. So one region is region one. And let me, I'm a little bit run out. I'll find out some part of a board here, which would be, I don't need anymore. So different regimes. So it will be region one, which is defined as k eta equal to unity, less than unity, for all eta up to present time. So there will be a region two. So region 2 is the one where we can neglect radiation and we can consider only matter as dominating both energy balance and perturbations. And that is when eta is exceeding eta zero. So let me just, I'm trying to choose my color. So this is region 1. So region 2 is this section. Region 2. And region 2 is defined that eta is larger than eta 0. And the third one, region that we will consider, is this one. Region 3. Maybe I switched my numbers, but okay, whatever it is. And that is when eta is less than eta equality. So this is a long wave regime. This is matter dominated. This is radiation dominated. But not only radiation dominated, but also, it's all the way to here. So that's my red regime. And so it is radiation dominated. Notice that I left a gap between the two. And in some sense, equations work out that you can really cleanly speak about matter dominated when eta exceeds eta zero, and cleanly radiation dominated when eta is less than eta equality. While on intermediate scales, it is a relatively extended transitional period. So, what things I am interested in as a function of a wave number? So, if I will draw the line of a present time, so maybe eta now, then I will be interested in a different perturbation quantities as a function of a wave number. So I will be, let me draw potential, phi of k here. So here is phi of k zero. Here is phi of k equality. Here is phi of k, which is even higher. So that is k less than eta now minus 1, and this is k larger than eta now minus 1, some particular number. I will think that actually I'm interested to know in the present time is gravitational potential and perturbations in a matter component. Most interesting one. So delta m in matter will be also interesting thing. And the quantities that I would like to, I erase my value, to plot at the end of the day is a spectrum. And spectrum will be kind of delta m as a function of k square. I'll speak a little bit more about random aspects of the amplitude, but that is not important for us. And as you see, different modes will have different history, and some of the modes will be coming at the long waves, exceeding it a zero. They had one history. The modes which are coming at very short waves have another history. So there will be a characteristic scales, k K0 minus 1, which is something like 550 megaparsec O minus 1, right? And K equality, which is 115 megaparsec minus 1 in for present day parameters. So there will be some long wave regime here, long wave. So there is something which is short wave regime here. And in between, there is some transitional stage. Which extends over factor of 5 in scales. Now, when we are solving equations piecewise, so roughly speaking, what can I solve analytically? In all of those three regions, and perhaps the boundary may be not so sharply seen nowadays. So I'll continue, maybe yellow, my color is messy. So in all three regions, I can solve essentially analytically perturbation problem, in practically all the glory. So in a long wave regime, I can have exact solutions, so we'll write it down. In a matter-dominated regime, I also have exact solutions, and you're probably well familiar with them, so I'll also write them down. And in a radiation-dominated regime, I also have exact solutions. We see that two and one regions here overlap. So for me, it is easy to match solutions in this regime where there is an overlap. Three and green and red here in a long wave regime also overlaps. So I can well match behavior of typical wave, which was first long wave, and then go in a short wave regime. Actually, I can write out a full solution true, so it works. But there is a central region, which is in this thing, where things are complicated. And do not allow for a very easy kind of analytical treatment. So in order to find out what happens with the perturbations in this regime, I need to match my solution here to here, but there is a jump, so there is a transition, and during the transition, ugly things can happen if there is no overlap. Fortunately, nothing ugly happens, but there are some kind of correction factors to deal with. Right, so from the point of view of what we are interested in, so here we're interested in potential and matter-dominated stage. Somewhere at near to recombination, we would be interested in what temperature fluctuations are. So we're interested in fluctuations in the energy density of photons, radiation, and also in potential as well, because all of them contribute to observable delta T over T. So somewhere at that time slice, I would be more looking towards phi and delta R or something. Notice that phi potential is actually a good quantity to drag through the whole story because it always exists, but perturbations in separate components are very subdominant on one state or another, and it's difficult to track them if you need at the stage when it is not dominant ones. So phi will be our guiding quantity throughout the story, throughout all the setup. What are approximations in this model, and what effects I definitely neglect? First of all, I did not consider independently variance. And variance is an interesting contribution to the energy density because they change the equation of state as things go on. At an early stages of the evolution, variance are tightly coupled to radiation. So they essentially may not be relativistic themselves at interesting times near recombination, but they are interacting through Coulomb forces very effectively with the, through scattering with the photons and between electrons and protons through Coulomb forces. So they actually modify the property of relativistic plasma, changing its speed of light, speed of sound as a main important effect. However, at the late time stages, when interactions with, when hydrogen became neutral and interaction with the photons cease, variance contribute to the matter component and cluster similarly to the matter until you get into interiors of the collapsed objects. So they are kind of part of plasma on this side, and contribution to dark to matter on this side, and as being part of plasma here, they have an imprint of oscillations in the plasma. So that would manifest later on as a baryon acoustic oscillation. All this story is beyond me, so I'm not doing it. So I will not get baryon acoustic oscillations in my final minimalistic spectrum. Second thing which happens, which is not part of the, actually you don't know yet, but will not be part of a story, is that we will use hydrodynamical approach to describe both relativistic radiation and matter, similar to how we wrote hydrodynamic energy momentum tensor for our perturbative theory. So we'll be using the quantity which appears in perturbations of that form. But photons, after they are being scattered, being last scattered, do not behave themselves as a hydrodynamical fluid. So they actually need to be treated after that, or even before that, through the recombination, as a by Boltzmann equation, as a kind of plasma which changes its optical depth from very high to very low, so it's becoming collisionless as recombination proceeds. So we will not do that. Therefore, formally speaking, fluid type description of radiation after recombination time is not valid. But given that radiation is becoming subdominant after that is not a big deal for us. But what is a kind of big deal is that not using full Boltzmann description for radiation, we cannot speak in detail what is happening with the microwave background of all the effects which are happening as plasma becomes transparent. In essence, what we can at best think of that there is a sharp transition from totally opaque to totally transparent plasma, which happens at a fixed time moment. So it's so-called approximation of recombination, which is good enough to describe sufficiently long modes, which were outside horizon at this time, and therefore long wave part of the CMB power spectrum. But it is not good to describe short modes where all physics are, interesting physics is happening, which leads to the bumps in the power spectrum and all the things. So this will not be our part of the story. Okay, so this is our setup. And now our job is to go to the perturbations equations and write them. I will not derive them from scratch, calculating all affine connections and then Ricci and Riemann tensors, well, Ricci tensors. So, but I will say a few words and just give them as they are. And we will be using a Newtonian longitudinal gauge. Ds square is equal a square 1 plus 2 phi d eta square minus 1 minus 2 psi gamma alpha beta dx alpha dx beta. And I will use the same notation as Professor Havens was using in his lectures on GR when he used the same gauge. First will be component will be phi, and second is psi with a minus sign. If we compare it with a Bardeen notation in this coordinate system, then phi is a, and psi is equal minus HL. However, we checked that in a Newtonian gauge, local to gauge quantities are becoming simply equal to correspondent gauge invariant variables. So you can think that about phi psi as a realization of perturbations in a particular gauge, or you can think about them as being gauge invariant variables. So equal phi of A of Bardeen, and psi is equal minus phi of H of Bardeen, right? So if I write my equation for phi psi, I just simply can relabel them and I have valid gauge invariant equations for gauge invariant quantities. So what quantities do describe my matter? We used to speak about energy momentum tensor as one single part of the right-hand side of Einstein equation, but now I have two matter components. So I have energy momentum tensor for matter, and I don't even know where to put index M. It looks like index. And I have energy momentum tensor for the radiation. The only thing general relativity tells me about them two is that, well, actually, its divergence, total divergence, vanishes. However, so now what quantities am I using to describe them? So I have for first one, delta M, which was a fluctuations in energy density. I had, let me just write it so that you remember what it is. So I had fluctuations in energy being background and delta M, and too many things. So there was a delta M, which was fluctuation of energy density. There was velocity V, and also so will carry matter being not vector index, but designating that this is matter, so it's a potential quantity. And then I have pi L, which was related to the fluctuations in pressure, and I have, so I should have M as well here. I don't know where to put my M's. And I have pi T for the matter as well, which is fluctuations in a off-diagonal components of the stress tensor. And similar things I have for radiation now, delta R, VR, pi L of R, and pi T for R. As I stressed several times, energy momentum tensor, and specifically total energy momentum tensor, on even more, which is an Einstein equation on the right-hand side, is not complete and closed description of a matter. It just expresses what how some parameters of a matter needs to be organized in order for conservation law, a covariant variation, hold. Right? So therefore, you do not get unique equations, just simply von Einstein equations, for all quantities that may be involved in describing how energy momentum tensor is perturbed. Really, you need to add a particular physical model for your matter to establish the link between different quantities. You have to do it even on a background level. You have energy density and pressure, and before you specify that there is some relation between pressure and energy density, called equation of state, you cannot move much further. So it is an extra information, extra modeling of real physical substance of your material that needs to go in. Now, if one example where issue is resolved is if material has Lagrangian description, because Lagrangian description is in a way assumed to be complete. You can derive equation of motions for all degrees of freedom which are in the Lagrangian equation. Example is that if you are dealing with perturbations in a scalar field, how inflationary models are based, and you will hear a lot probably about scalar fields through the inflationary talks, then you can derive from scalar field and its derivative all components of the energy momentum tensor, but you really have for a given field just one scalar, four scalar degree of freedom. Right, and the rest is all construction out of that. Our hydrodynamical description is not of that nature, so we have to put an extra knowledge into, or extra ideas into linking different parts of the descriptors. And in essence, we'll do two. First of all, we'll ask ourselves, we'll not ask ourselves, but really not so much assume as perhaps model. We'll say that equation of state for perturbed material is the same as an equation of state for background. So that if I change an energy density at a given place, then my pressure change in accord, so that ratio of them remains the same. So P over E is equal P0 over E0, which kind of tells me that 1 plus PL and 1 plus delta is equal to 1. So pi L is equal delta in this case. So in this case, these things are equated. If it is not so, then it reduces an additional mod for the solution, which traditionally was called entropy fluctuations, which is essentially appears when the pressure and density, energy density is perturbed not in accord, but there is a difference between them. Currently, to some extent, looking at energy, at entropy mode becomes, language becomes out of fashion to some extent. In essence, entropy modes appears more often when you have material which consists from different elements. One has one equation of state, the other has another equation of state. And what is happening is that they are perturbed not in accord with each other, so equation of state fluctuates with the perturbations. Rather than tracking this possibility for an ideal fluid in one component. So if the situation of entropy perturbation is achieved by varying contributions of different ingredients, Then you usually talk about Isaacovich perturbation rather than entropy one. So the entropy dropped out of the language to some extent dropped out from the language. Now, for an ideal fluid which sits in a thermal equilibrium, right? In essence, you think that your equilibrium is fast enough that it will adjust the pressure if energy density locally change sufficiently fast. So second thing that what we need to do is we have a last quantity pi of t, which is anisotropic part of a stress. This quantity is gauge invariant by construction. So in that sense, it is either present or it is not present. You cannot modify it by choosing gauge that this quantity is not there. And it is whether it needs to be included in description or not depends solely on the fact whether your matter, type of matter, supports anisotropic stresses. And if you have ideal fluid, it does not support anisotropic stresses. So when you model your radiation and dust-like matter as an ideal fluid, there is PT is equal to zero. If you are having a scalar field, then you'll find out that off-diagonal terms of the energy momentum tensor is a product of two special derivatives, phi alpha, phi beta, alpha not equal beta. And since first derivative with respect to space is a first-order quantity, then it is only quadratic quantity. So in that sense, in linear series, individual scalar field does not support off-diagonal stresses either. They don't appear. But for example, if you describe some material with the help of a distribution function, and so it is collisionless, so it's not an ideal fluid which is equalizes, but the collisionless one, example can be neutrinos, which do not interact with anything, and it should be described as collisionless fluid, then anisotropic stresses are possible. Well, they are automatically arise, you can evaluate correspondent integrals over distribution function, and they don't vanish. So in this case, this term is not zero, but you know how to compute it, because again, all energy momentum tensor is reduced to the distribution function. You model your distribution function and not anything else. So that is, some of you were asking after first part, so what happened with the rest of the pieces of energy momentum tensor, what are we going to do with that? So that's what. There is another thing which you model or not model, is again, you have a sum of two energy momentum tensors for which you know, or more if you have more components, and you want to treat them separately. So you know the total divergence is zero. So the question is whether individual divergence of each individual energy momentum tensor is zero or not, whether they're conserved one by one. Total conservation is enforced by Einstein equation. It can be derived from Einstein equation. Individual conservation is your model. It is conserved if two components do not have direct interaction by other forces than gravity. And if they do have direct interaction by some other forces, then divergence of each energy momentum tensor will have a source term, and there will be, if there's two, there will be two different source terms with opposite signs so that the total is zero. So in that sense, if you want, you need to, or if you need, you need to model interactions. Fortunately, so that, for example, comes in a game if one of the component is baryons. So baryons are interacting with radiation. So they should not be treated as two separately conserved energy momentum tensors. But in that case, you are also going beyond hydrodynamical description, but use really Boltzmann descriptions for photons and everything. But in the simplest model, matter is kind of cold dark matter, which does not interact with anything, including the photons. And so we will keep our two terms independent, and therefore we'll have separately conservation law for matter part, and separately conservation law, so that's for matter, for radiation part. So our equations for perturbations will arise from Einstein equations plus equations of motion of individual component. Some part is repetitive, because again, sum of the two equal to zero is already contained in Einstein equation. And I guess it is probably the good moment to stop, because next we'll be just writing equations out and solving them. And I will not be able to do that in 2 minutes, right? No. So I'll stop here today. Questions? No, I'm impressed how clearly I'm speaking. There are no questions. Everything is